As Kate Ceberano pointed out in the video, Melbourne has historically been ahead of the game in this respect. We are very fortunate in our history, our city fathers, as they were then described, going right back to the 19th century. And the consequence of that and all of the progressive changes we've made since then is that in Melbourne, you can literally be among tall buildings and traffic 1 minute, and you can be lying under a tree the next. And again, I think the video showed very clearly the profusion of parkland in and around our city, and indeed across Victoria, and what that means to Victorians of all ages. And so that's why our government, our state government, is continuing to invest very heavily in our parks. And I'm particularly proud of our creation last year of the River Red Gum Parks along the Murray River, which we enacted through legislation last year. And if you've ever seen those magnificent trees, you'll understand why. If you've ever seen red gums that are 200, 300, 350 years and more old, they are part of our history, part of our heritage, part of our natural beauty, and they are such a beautiful part of Victoria. And so these majestic red gums, which have stood along the riverside for centuries, will now be protected for generations and indeed for centuries to come. And they do need that protection. And that's just one example, but it's one that Gavin and I are particularly proud of. And I noticed Peter Garrett nodding his head in furious agreement. It's a great addition to our national estate. But in the last 3 years, we've also created the Kibobbany National Park in the west of our state, something that Gavin was particularly proud of. We funded three new parks at Tulurn Creek, at Merry Creek and along the Werribee River. We've created the Great Ocean Walk, 91 kilometres from Apollo Bay to the 12 Apostles. And this walk is the star of our new $2 million campaign to attract nature-based tourism to Victoria's amazing coastline. And again, I've never known anybody who's not gone out and done one of the walks through our parks, or like this new walk here along the Great Ocean Walk, and not come back impassioned about our parks and the environment. We've also recently created a new $10 million underwater park. This is the sinking of HMAS Canberra, has meant that Victorians now have a unique opportunity to discover the maritime world off the coast at Barwon River. We recently redeveloped Queenscliff Harbour, a $40 million project to provide the best maritime facilities on Port Phillip Bay, but in turn then allowing unprecedented access to the various maritime and terrestrial parks. We're spending $14 million on the new Point Nepean National Park, and of course we've initiated the Healthy Parks, Healthy People Directorate within Parks Victoria to specifically work on connecting communities to the natural environment, that is, on connecting people to parks. In fact, here in Victoria, I think we've got one of the best possible examples of the Healthy Parks, Healthy People philosophy in action. Our Royal Children's Hospital, which if many of you came in today along Flemington Road, you would have seen, is the best paediatric hospital in Australia, one of the best in the world, but the infrastructure is 60 years old, and so we're completely rebuilding it at a cost of $1 billion. And I mention it because the new hospital, the new children's hospital, will be the greenest hospital anywhere in Australia. And we see it not only as a hospital in a park, but when you see it complete, it's also, in a sense, a park in a hospital. The design draws on all of the latest research into the benefits of patient contact with nature. 80% of patients' rooms will have direct views of Royal Park. Every ward will have an outdoor terrace. Throughout the hospital, there will be enormous expanses of outdoor space. And again, you can imagine the type of difference that this will make for some of the sickest kids in Australia, including those who come from overseas for treatment at the children's. And I think the new children's hospital is an example of bringing parks to the people, building park spaces into urban environments. And you put all of that together, I think it's vital that we continue to encourage more people into our parks. And I mentioned at the beginning of my speech that Gavin and I had just made an important announcement because our government is determined to provide every incentive for Victorian families to get out and about into our magnificent parks. So today we announced that from July the 1st this year, our government will be removing all park entry fees across Victoria. And that means that every national park managed by Parks Victoria and every metropolitan park will be absolutely free to enter. And by the way, we're making sure that Parks Victoria is not out of pocket from that as well, because it would be silly to do that and to shortchange them. But when you think of what this would mean in terms of families, we've still got lots of families. We've got lots of families across the state that for them, $10, $20, $30 can make a big difference about whether they go to one of our magnificent parks, whether it's the Rhododendron Gardens, whether it's Werribee Park, whether it's Bulbul, whether it's Point Nepean. This will open up the parks for those people. We have free entry to the National Gallery of Victoria. It's one of the 10 most visited galleries last year in the world. A few years ago, we halved the price of entrance to our beautiful Museum of Victoria, and we found that after doing that, the number of families who took their children to the museum rose dramatically. And I think you're going to see the same thing in relation to our parks. And Parks Victoria estimates that we'll probably see attendance levels up by 25% or more. But what a wonderful thing to get more children, more families out into our beautiful park. What a wonderful thing too for more elderly Victorians and more pensioners, for whom watching every dollar is often important, to make sure that they can get the benefit and they can visit our beautiful parks across the state. And what a great thing too to do on World Health Day, when we have to work out how we tackle this problem of this epidemic of preventable disease, and what better way to do it than to encourage Victorians to get out there, to visit our parks, to walk through our parks, to appreciate their beauty and to get the benefit from that. And so I think this is another big step towards making the healthy parks, healthy people philosophy a reality here in Victoria. Finally, can I just say today that Victoria is changing, and parks are going to play a major role in that change in the future. Our state is a very popular place to be. We're adding more people each year than at any time in our history. And so we are growing bigger, but we're also going to get smarter and we're going to get greener. We will manage our growing population and we will protect our famous livability. We're determined to build a Victoria that respects and indeed embraces our precious environmental heritage, a healthy, productive, sustainable, livable and breathable Victoria, and a Victoria that's nurtured and energised and revitalised by its parks. So can I today thank everybody whose hard work has gone into organising this inaugural Healthy Parks, Healthy People Congress. And I hope it may be the first of many. And I'm delighted that we've had more than 1,000 registrants, as I said, from more than 35 countries around the world. And so to everyone here today, can I again welcome you? Can I say I hope you enjoy your time in Melbourne and in Victoria, that you do manage to spend time visiting our magnificent parks across our state, and I hope you find the next few days stimulating and inspiring. Thank you.